Hello there, hockey fans. On today's video, we take a deep look at part one of Paul Coffey's career, the Oilers' years. We dig deep at one of the most storied players of his time, an offensive blue liner who was a brilliant skater, and hell, even made instructional VHS videos on how to skate. I'm sure you can find them at a Tilly's or a Value Village near you. Many have criticized his, well, lack of actual defensive skills, but I say to that, who the hell cares? He wasn't paid to be Rod Langway. I will also preface this series by saying that other blue liners who racked up offensive numbers, such as Ray Bourque, Hal McInnes, and even Larry Murphy, were much more complete and dynamic defensemen. But none of those names in my eyes, and I'm sure in the eyes of many others, especially those fans who watched him for close to 7 years as part of the Edmonton Oilers team, none of them were as exciting and as purely skilled at what he did than Paul Coffey. Throughout this series, we will zero in on certain aspects of his career, the main one being how he clicked with the big stars. Throughout his career, Coffey has played with some of the biggest names of the era. Gretzky, Lemieux, Yzerman, even Eric Lindros for a time. Some argue that's the only reason Coffey is great. Okay, well in that case, the only reason Sidney Crosby is great is because of Malkin. The only reason Ovechkin is great is because of Backstrom. Some of you are likely already saying that's an utterly ridiculous statement to make, and you'd be right. Because many who are the best play with the best. Sure, Mario Lemieux was already great for a long while before he had the likes of Kevin Stevens, Ron Francis, Jaromir Jagr, Mark Recchi, Larry Murphy, and yes, Paul Coffey by his side. But when exactly did he start winning Stanley Cups, I ask you? Dominic Hasek was a phenomenal goaltender. And fans in Canada's adopted U.S. nation can cry all they want about 1999, but the fact remains it was unlikely he'd win a Stanley Cup there anyway. It took him joining a stacked Detroit team to win one. I could make hundreds of examples, but that's another video for another day. But I digress, and indeed, while the Gretzky-Curry combination is probably one of the best of all time, we will compare that at the end to, of course, the Gretzky-Coffey era as well. Paul Coffey was born June 1st, 1961 in Weston, Ontario, Canada, which was a Toronto-area community. Starting hockey at a young age, he was winning many accolades even in his youth. As a matter of fact, he played in the Quebec International Pee Wee Hockey Tournament in 1974, the same tournament that would feature Denny Savard and some kid from Brantford, Ontario. Coffey was playing for the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds of the OHL by the age of 17. His stats, needless to say, were, well, amazing. In his final season of junior hockey, Coffey split time between the Sioux as well as the Kitchener Rangers. He had 29 goals and 73 assists for 102 points in 75 games. Needless to say, he was a top prospect going into the 1980 NHL entry draft. It was he, alongside with Dave Babich and Larry Murphy and others, that were among the top defensive prospects in this draft. He had been taken 6th overall by the Edmonton Oilers, a team that was simply known for two things. One being in Edmonton, and that aforementioned kid from Brantford, Ontario was becoming a phenomenon. But as the 1980-81 training camp got underway, the Oilers were entering the NHL as the youngest team in the entire league. As a matter of fact, the average overall age was 23.8 years old. This is where the Oilers dynasty was finally about to start to take shape. In their first season in 1979-80 in the NHL, that is, the team did have Marc Messier and Kevin Lowe in addition to Wayne Gretzky, but Messier was sparingly used, and Lowe, while having a solid year, was also evolving. 1980-81 is where we'd see the likes of Glenn Anderson and Gary Curry join the club in addition to Coffey. Marc Messier would start getting more ice time and becoming more offensively productive. Gretzky, of course, was setting NHL records. This particular year, assists with 109 and points with 164 to go with Gretzky's 55 goals. As for Coffey, he had a very good rookie campaign, playing 74 games with 9 goals and 23 assists for 32 points. He was third amongst rookie defensemen in scoring that year, behind Dave Babich with 44, and Larry Murphy, who set a rookie defenseman record that still stands to this day as I record this, with 76 points, and was the first runner-up to the Calder Trophy, losing to Quebec's Peter Stastny. Neither Coffey or Babich, or for that matter even Yari Curry, registered a single vote for the Calder Trophy. To be fair, it was a year stacked with Rookie of the Year candidates like Denny Savard, Glenn Anderson, Don Beaupre, Daryl Sutter, Steve Kasper, and Anton Stastny. all of whom got votes. So we won't fault the NHL much there. So how did Coffey fare with Gretzky in his first season? Well, Gretzky had a record 109 assists, as I said, and 55 goals. And of those goals, Coffey assisted on 7 of them, tied for 5th on the club. Out of the 9 goals Coffey scored in his rookie year, Gretzky assisted on 4 of them, for a 44.4% rate. So now, we look at who collaborated Gretzky with the most on his 109 assists that year. And Coffey, well, he was actually tied for 2nd along with fellow blue liner Risto Siltanen with 8 times, as Brett Callaghan runs away with it for 16. Even with just 23 assists all year, just over a third of Coffey's assists were along with the great one. Then the playoffs came. Back then, it was literally 16-seeded madness. The first overall team would face the 16th overall team, second faces the 15th, you get the idea. However, the third place team was the Montreal Canadiens. And while their Stanley Cup dynasty had ended the prior season, they were still a top-tier contender and a 100-point club. Lafleur, Schutt, Robinson, Gainey were all present and accounted for. The Oilers were young, inexperienced, but growing in their own cohesiveness, and they happened to be the 14th place club. Absolutely no chance, right? Just one of the biggest upsets, however, in Stanley Cup playoff history. The Oilers shocked the Habs in a series sweep. Their trek was beginning. As for Coffey, he had 5 points in 3 games, tied for 3rd on the team in scoring, and was also a +7. He even outplayed, and dare we say schooled his counterpart, a playoff legend, 5-time Stanley Cup winner Larry Robinson. Next up, they had to face the New York Islanders, the dominant first place overall defending Stanley Cup champions. Could Lightning strike twice for the Oilers and upsetting another powerhouse? They went the distance but lost in 6 games. Coffey saw his production take a drop and was taken apart by the powerful Isles, the likes of Mike Bossy, Brian Trottier, and Butch Goring. Be that as it may, his rookie year was a success. 9 goals, 23 assists, 32 points, 3rd among rookie defensemen, and key in the Oilers' playoff upset over Montreal. Going into the 1981-82 season, the Oilers were still a young team. But after their coming out party and the fact that Gretzky is, well, Gretzky, the sophomore year proved to be an improvement for the likes of Curry, Anderson, and our friend Paul Coffey. 29 goals, 60 assists for 89 points, led all defensemen scoring, and was a +35 to boot. The Oilers' talent was dominating, and they were now a 100-point club and 2nd overall in the league. But, wait, he lost? He lost the Norris Trophy? And he came in 3rd? Sorry, ladies and gents, but this isn't just about stats, which he was ahead of both finalists. To be fair to Ray Bourque, he did miss 15 games and was still excellent because, well, he's Ray Bourque. But Doug Wilson did not deserve this award, in my opinion. He was often inconsistent despite his stats, and the Hawks were not that good of a team as they should have been with the talent they had at that point as well. This is where we get to the meat and potatoes of Paul Coffey and how he works with the big stars. As we all know, Gretzky had an insane year, 92 goals shattering the record of 76 in a single season previously held by one Phil Esposito, 120 assists beating his own record of 109 the year prior, 212 points, yes, 212 points, shattering the record of 164 set by himself. But see, while many and rightfully so credit Yari Curry, let's see how the Coffey and Gretzky duo and how they matched up. Out of Gretzky's 92 goals, Coffey assisted on 25 of them. That's more than a quarter. At just over 27.1%, that's the best on the team. Out of Coffey's 29 goals, Gretzky assisted on 12 of them. That's almost half. But let's see how many times they teamed up on assists. Gretzky teamed with 20 different players collaborating on assists in 81-82. Glenn Anderson tops with 15. Risto Siltanen and Yari Curry were tied with 12. As Coffey was 4th with 10, as all 4 men were the only double-digit assist collaborators with Wayne that year. It looked as if the Oilers were well on their way to a dream final against the New York Islanders that would excite the hockey world. All they had to do was beat a pathetic Kings team to start the first round, and Well, okay. They lost game one. It was an ugly outing, but hey, these things tend to happen in the playoffs. The underdog gets fortunate and take a game or two sometimes. It was happening to the Islanders at that very time with the Penguins. Game two was way too close for comfort, but hey, Wayne saves the day in overtime. They have momentum now, and the series is tied. The fluke is definitely over. The Cinderella story is about to turn into the proverbial pumpkin going into Game 3 in LA. And lo and behold, a 1, a 2, a 3, a 4, and a 5. 5-0 Oilers after the second period. Glenn Sather is laughing, and the team is in cruise control. So now we go to the third period. Wait, okay, well, one goal isn't much, plus the Kings team does have a lot of talent, despite their bad year, and, okay, two goals, still, the Oilers are in the driver's seat, and three goals, okay, Grant, seriously, getting a little too close for comfort again, but I'm sure this Oilers team will, four goals, are you, five, four, okay, breathe, okay, it's down to the final minute, LA, you had your fun, you excited your fans a little bit, But now the Oilers just need to protect the lead, and you got this, Wayne. Jim Fox stripped you of the puck. No. It can't be. You blew a 5-goal lead. Oh, okay. Well, look, smarten up. There's still overtime, and it's like some sort of miracle on Manchester. Well, the Oilers are on the verge of elimination. Tell me it isn't so. What's this? Oh, the Oilers play a much more disciplined and even a bit of a defensive game in Game 4 and tie the series, going into the fifth and deciding game in Edmonton. Sorry, LA, you will always have Game 3 and your fans will always remember it. But now you're going back to Edmonton and... it happened and they let it happen. And as for our friend Paul Coffey, he was largely ineffective in this series and was outplayed by his contemporary dating back to his junior days, Larry Murphy. Regardless, Coffey had a great year. 29 goals, 60 assists, 89 points, leading all defensive and scoring. And to boot, played in his first NHL All-Star game, he was a second-team All-Star and a finalist for the Norris Trophy. I'm sure any one can tell you who is an avid sports fan or involved in the game itself, that in order to be a champion, you need to take some lumps and learn some lessons along the way, no matter how good you are. And to their credit, they weren't the immature kids they were the year before going into the 1982-83 season. They seemed a lot more focused. They finished with 106 points, tied for second best record in the league with the Philadelphia Flyers, and only 4 points behind first place overall Boston. Coffey, in a word, was superb. 29 goals, 67 assists, for 96 points. Again, led all defensemen in scoring, and the only blue liner not named Denny Potvin or Bobby Orr to reach 95 or more points. An unbelievable outing. But let's specify how he and Gretzky clicked this season, as the great one had 196 points. Must have been a slow year. 71 goals and 125 assists, again breaking his own assist record. Out of Wayne's 71 goals, Coffey assisted on 15 of them, 21.1%, second best on the team. Why only second best? Well, that's because in first place, Yari Kurri was assisted on a huge 25 goals, assisting on 35.2% of them. Out of Coffey's 67 assists, 22.3% of them were to Gretzky. That's nearly a quarter, despite being down from last year's number. Also, Coffey again tied his career high of 29 goals, and Gretzky assisted on 10 of them, 34.5%, only slightly down from last year. But again, we look at the assist collaborations, and this year was a tight race. Yari Kurri led the way with 25 assists, but Coffey was only just behind at 21, and the two were highly ahead of Glenn Anderson and Mark Messier following them. These numbers show growth for the Oilers, however, and how Kurri and Coffey looked to be Gretzky's top go-to guys, but still had several other options, of course. As for Norris Trophy voting, he came in fifth. He wasn't even a finalist this year. 96 points, not to mention he was plus 52, only third in the league, only behind his teammates, Charlie Huddy and Wayne Gretzky. And Doug Wilson again got more votes. Okay, to be fair, the Blackhawks actually had a really good year, and Wilson's career I thought was better this year than last year. But he was, again, a second-team All-Star, but how is he not a finalist? Again, I think it's those, he's not a defensive player, folks, that voted. Anyway, moving on, let's focus on the playoffs, shall we? The Oilers were destined and determined not to make the same mistakes they had the year before. And they didn't take any team lightly, but they certainly were, taking them. The Oilers did sweep out the Winnipeg Jets, but it wasn't as dominant as you might think, as the final two games in the best of three series were only decided by a goal. Coffey himself played well, two goals and was a plus four. In the second round, though the Oilers were truly unstoppable in the best of seven series against the Calgary Flames, the first meeting of those two storied rivals ever in a playoff series, they outscored the Flames a combined total of 35-13. Coffey was outstanding, 5 goals and 3 assists for 8 points, as the Oilers won the series in just 5 games. It was the best Coffey had played in a playoff series since the upset over Montreal in 81. In the conference finals, it was much of the same against the Chicago Blackhawks. More domination. The Oilers swept the series and were on their way to their first ever Stanley Cup Finals. Coffey's scoring stats may not have been dominant, but 3 assists in 4 games is nothing to balk at, and oh yes, he was still a plus 8. At last, the Oilers had learned their lesson. Ready to dethrone those old fogies, the New York Islanders, their time was up. Despite the fact that they were 3-time defending Stanley Cup champions, and well, I think that's something the Canadian sports media may have forgotten. Game 1 is in Edmonton. The crowd is amped at Northlands Coliseum. The time has come for... Oh, the Oilers are shut out by a slight margin of 2-0 in Game 1. Billy Smith making 35 saves. Well, I mean, hey, it's going to be expected. Smith has won 3 Stanley Cups, for crying out loud. Nothing to panic about. The Oilers just ran into a hot goaltender. Game 2, the Oilers do score goals. 3, as a matter of fact. But the Islanders, well, they scored 6. Okay, look, the Islanders are 3-time defending champions. Of course, they're going to do something shocking like take 2 games on the road. But the Oilers will regroup, and after all, they are a good road team. No way going to Long Island, the city of champions, is going to intimidate Wayne and... Wait, 5-1? 5-1? And Billy Smith has his 3rd straight 30-save game of the series? Yeah, I'm done being a smartass here. The Oilers got swept loose in Game 4, 4-2, completing an utter humiliation. Gretzky had 4 assists in this series, but the problem is he had about as many goals as I've had dates with Avril Lavigne. Coffey was not very good either. To be fair, though, however, neither was the rest of the team on the Oilers. But since the video is mainly about the star blue liner himself, he had just 1 assist and no goals and was minus 5. The worst on the team. Paul was also schooled by fellow offensive blue liner, team captain, and future Hall of Famer, Denny Potvin. Where, oh where, did it all go wrong? The Oilers once again were outclassed. They weren't necessarily cocky. Hell, they weren't even taking the Islanders lightly, per se. But they were certainly getting ahead of themselves. Regardless, Coffey can still be proud of another great season. 29 goals, 67 assists for 96 points, leading all defensemen in scoring for the second straight year. His second All-Star game appearance, and another second All-Star team selection, and until the finals, was superb in the playoffs. The 1983-84 season saw the Oilers once again try a new approach. For one, Wayne Gretzky felt that after seeing how beaten up the Islanders looked after walking by their locker room after the Stanley Cup was over, realized they have to have more of a warrior aspect to their game in the playoffs, not just rely on their immense talent. They definitely had that for sure. Even in 1982-83, there was no team, perhaps with more insanely amazing talent on their team than the Oilers, but the Islanders had depth. They had grit. And oh yes, star players of their own to boot, let's not forget. But even those players reached out for something extra come playoff time. That's why they were so successful. The Oilers knew they'd have to do that too. Wayne Gretzky was also named captain of the club and took his role very seriously. The Oilers had their best regular season yet, 57 wins, only 3 short of 60, a record held at the time by the Montreal Canadiens of 1976-77. A total of 119 points, by far the best team in the league. Paul Coffey, you ask? Well, let's see. He became the first defenseman since Bobby Frickin' Orr to score 40 goals in a season. On top of that, 86 assists, a career high totaling 126 points. Lots of career highs for Paul Coffey and plus 52. He's the third defenseman to do so, reaching this mark of 100 points, the others being, of course, Bobby Orr and Denny Potvin. So yes, needless to say, he led all defensemen in scoring for a third straight year and was second in the entire league. Pretty sure you can guess who he was behind. And also by the end of that season, Coffey's 126 was a third best mark by a defenseman in NHL history at that point, behind Bobby Orr marks of 135 and 139. Now as for Gretzky, he scored 87 goals, his second best mark ever, and 118 assists for 205 points. And you ask, where did Paul factor in? Well, out of Wayne's 87 goals, Paul assisted on 24 of them, nearly 21%, only second behind, you guessed it, Yari Kurri. But both Coffey and Kurri were miles ahead of everyone in that stat. And indeed, out of Coffey's 40 goals, Gretzky assisted on 13 of them, 32.5% of Coffey's goals. Number one, of course. But now we look again on the assist collaborations. Gretzky had 118 assists that year, and boy, I hate it when a player slumps. Coffey led the way with 20. Yari Kurri, however, did miss 16 games, but still came in second with 17. Either way, Coffey leads this category for the first time. Will Coffey obtain the Norris Trophy? Well, that would be a no. He was, however, the first runner-up this time to Rod Langway, who took it home for a second year straight. And yes, Langway would score about as many goals in a year as Gretzky would score in a given weekend. But that being said, he was a traditional stay-at-home defender in a game that had very few nowadays. And he earned the award with no question, as he helped turn the Washington Capitals a perennial joke with a playoff team with winning records. But at least Coffey was starting to get his due from the awards voters, and he even came in 10th in Hart Trophy voting, and was only a second All-Star team selection again? Well, anyway, now it was time for the playoffs, and it would be very little shock if the Oilers make it back to the big game. It was not a first-round meeting with the Jets. Outside of a thrilling OT game in Game 2, the Oilers were dominant, sweeping in three games straight again. And Coffey tied the lead in scoring in the series with 6 points and was a plus 7. And now it was time for part 2 of the Battle of Alberta, and boy oh boy, this one would not be easy. After a solid win in Game 1, the Oilers were shocked in overtime for Game 2 tying the series. Coffey was struggling somewhat, but scored 2 goals in Game 3 to give the Oilers a 3-2 win in the series lead at 2-1. And a 5-3 win meant they were going back to Edmonton for Game 5, but oh no, the Flames are back. They take it on the road. In Game 6, the heroics of Lanny McDonald force a Game 7. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Lanny in overtime, always dangerous. Yeah, well, I mean, the finals may not even be an option now. And they may once again learn a harsh lesson. Never mind. The Oilers take Game 7 with a 7-4 win and move to the conference final. Despite struggles, Coffey was there when it mattered, notching 7 points in 7 games. Okay, so now was a new opponent in the conference finals, the Minnesota North Stars, who had tremendous talent, the likes of Dynamo Dino Cicerelli, Craig Hartsburg, Brian Bellows, and Neil Broughton. But they were no match for the Oilers, who swept them out pretty easily to return to the Stanley Cup Finals. Coffey had 5 points in the 4 games and was a plus 7, playing excellently throughout these playoffs. But now the Oilers once again must face the team that humiliated them the year before, the now 4-time defending Stanley Cup champion New York Islanders. This year the Oilers may be a more dominant club, but this team, while they still may be young, they're not so inexperienced, but can they outclass the best in the game so far in the 80s? Game 1. Wow, Billy Smith of the Islanders is doing it again, but stopping everything at sight, but wait a second. So is Grant Fuhr of the Oilers. Okay, this is different, and hey, what do you know? The Oilanders got a goal. Good enough for a 1-0 win at taking the first game. Not bad, not bad at all. Game two, however, oh no, here we go again. 6-1 Islanders. The Oilers absolutely decimated. And it's looking bleak going back to Edmonton for game three. The series tied. No one has faith in the Oilers now. And indeed it is 2-1 in the second period for the Islanders. Oh dear, this is not looking good. The Oilers just look like a lifeless and tired bunch. And oh, thanks Marc Messier. Well, there's hope after all, and the game is tied in, oh wow, a 7-2 win. And they take the series lead. And in game three, another 7-2 win? Is this really happening? Can this team be stopped? Well, that would be a no. They take game five, score a 5-2, and the Oilers are at last Stanley Cup champions. Coffey played very well in the finals. 2 goals, 2 assists for 4 points, and was a +4. And more importantly than anything, he has his name on the Stanley Cup and a Stanley Cup ring on his finger, and was a major contributor all through these playoffs. And oh yes, this time it was he who dominated counterpart Denny Potvin. So I'd say it was a great year for Paul Coffey, to say the least. 40 goals, 86 assists, 126 points, all career highs. Third best ever for a defenseman, second in the league in scoring, a second team all-star selection, and a championship ring, and his name on the most immortal trophy in the game. Well, Paul Coffey is on top of the world. He is a champion and dominating at his position, and being revered as one of the best in the game. But some are still puzzled how he lost the Norris Trophy once again. Some feel he should at least have one at this point. Some say it's lack of actual defense. But the Oilers had that covered with the likes of veteran Lee Fogelin, Charlie Huddy, despite what a certain YouTube video may say about him, as well as Randy Gregg and, of course, future Hall of Famer Kevin Lowe. Coffey was not meant to be a traditional defenseman. Deal with it, people! But I doubt it ain't at him. After all, he was just coming off hoisting the biggest trophy in the game. And now in September of 1984, before he would embark on defending that said trophy, he got to play for Team Canada in the third ever Canada Cup tournament, with 7 of his Oilers teammates. And even their coach, Glenn Sather, was leading the way. Jari Kurri himself was playing for his native Finland. Team Canada was having communication issues, as they had a decent yet not outstanding round robin, yet somehow still made the playoffs. Rumors over the years, and even accounts from the likes of Montreal Canadiens legend Larry Robinson, said that the other players just couldn't get on the same page. The Oilers and the Islanders had quite a rivalry, a lot of egos involved. So, I mean, it's no surprise, especially with the Islanders and Oilers kind of at each other's throats. I mean, hell, the Islanders had just won 4 Stanley Cups and the Oilers just killed that, pretty much. And they just basically did not like each other for the most part. And the Islanders themselves had significant representation in this tournament with 4 players on Team Canada and Brian Troche playing for Team USA. Traitor! Anyway, yes, questions of Coffey's actual defensive play came up again. And it's going to kill Canada. Semi-finals against the heavily favored Soviet Union team who humiliated Canada back in 81 at the last Canada Cup, and we've gone to overtime and... Oh no, look at this! 2-man rush! Only Coffey to beat! We're doomed! And... because you can't play defense! Wait, what was that? Wait, what did I just see? What? Okay, well, he got lucky once, and Canada wins! And it all started with Coffey's defensive play. I said it more than once. That wasn't his job to be a traditional defenseman. But my point here is that, be in Edmonton or for his country or wherever, Coffey made defensive plays when he had to for the most part. So to wrap up this little dandy of a story, Canada swept Sweden in the finals and won the Canada Cup. Coffey now has a Canada Cup ring to go in his jewelry case. He's walked away with 3 goals and 8 assists for 11 points in 8 games, and wow, hey, he was named to the Canada Cup All-Star team. And it was indeed a huge start of the year for Coffey in the 1984-85 season, and while he fell slightly short from his numbers from the previous year, it was no biggie at all. Well, actually, it still kind of was, as he had 37 goals and 84 assists for 121 points. And again, yes, led all defensemen in scoring for the fourth consecutive year. And to boot, set the fifth single-season highest scoring mark for a blue liner, a career-high plus 57 as well. Good enough for fourth best in the league. And guess what? He was the fifth highest scorer in the league to boot. And well, as you could see by that chart, Gretzky had an insanely good year. What else is new? And part of the season, of course, was scoring 73 goals. Out of 73 goals, Coffey assisted on 20 of them. Not bad at all, 27.4%, and again only behind Yari Kurri with an astonishing 30. Meaning out of Coffey's 84 assists, nearly a quarter of them were to Gretzky's goals. Also out of Coffey's 37 goals, Gretzky assisted on 19. Over half, 51.4%. And now once again, we take a look at the assist collaborations. Paul Coffey leads again, this time with 26, edging out Yari Kurri with 23. But again, they are at the top, as Charlie Huddy makes the list once again, as does new Gretzky linemate Mike Krushelnicki. The Oilers are a more complete team now than they were even last year, when they won the Cup. Speaking of which, how did the Oilers do in the regular season? Well, they had 109 points, quite down from 119 the previous year, but still the second best record in the league, only 4 points behind a revamped Philadelphia Flyer squad led by new GM, legendary Flyer Bob, I'm retired so don't call me Bobby anymore, Clark, and rookie head coach Mike Keenan, who at this point was only obsessed with Oilers players for a different reason. Anyway, oh, I almost forgot. How did our friend do in Norris Trophy voting this year? Well, funny you should ask! By golly, he has finally done it! Is it to say, hey, look, this guy is still good in his position, regardless if he's not doing what we want him to do? Indeed, this is Paul Coffey's first Norris Trophy win, oh, but it was only about to get better because now we had the Stanley Cup playoffs again. First up was the opening round series against the ageless Marcel Dion, along with the likes of Bernie Nichols and a heavily improved Los Angeles Kings team led by coach Pat Quinn. It was a sweep, however, for the defending champs, but games 1 and 3 both went into overtime. And Coffey was excellent. 2 goals, 2 assists, 4 points in 3 games, and a plus 7, tied for best in the series. So moving on to the next round, it was a very talented Winnipeg Jets team who had their best year ever with 96 points. However, sadly for the Jets, they were without their top player and Dale Hawerchuk, who was out the rest of the season due to injury. While the Jets were competitive in a couple of games, with that old ducky, they didn't stand a chance. The Oilers swept them in 4 straight games, and Coffey was the second best in scoring with 4 goals, 4 assists for 8 points in just 4 games, and was a series best plus 9, my goodness. So in just 7 games and 2 rounds at this point, Paul Coffey has 12 points as a playoff leading plus 16. Standing in the way of Edmonton's hot streak, however, is a highly talented Chicago Blackhawk team. Denny Savard, Steve Larmer, Murray Bannerman, and yes, our friend Doug Wilson. It looks like it's going to be smooth sailing for Edmonton. They obliterate the Hawks in the first 2 games, but the old boys from Chi-Town come back in Game 3 in a huge way and edge out the Oilers once again in Game 4 as the two teams combine for 14 goals. But the Oilers again took them apart in the next 2 games, as it remains the highest scoring playoff series of all time to date. It's a total of goals were scored of 69, 44 for Edmonton, and 25 for Chicago. Paul Coffey was again outstanding, 3 goals and 11 assists for 14 points and a plus 7. Remarkable. You know what else is remarkable? The fact that that was only good enough to be tied for third best in the series! any other time, that would be ridiculous to even be number one. Yari Curry set a record of goals in the series with 12. Gretzky set a record of points with 18. And now for the third straight year, the Oilers are back in the Stanley Cup Finals looking for back-to-back cups as a new foe emerges in the Philadelphia Flyers. Both teams look sharp in the first two games in Philly as they split them. The Oilers, however, take Game 3 in a tight-knit 4-3 battle that saw Coffey assist on all the Oiler goals that night. Coffey has a three-point night to boot in Game 4. And hey, you know, another big night in series clinching Game 5 as the Oilers dominated 8-3, two goals and an assist for number 7. 10 points in three games. Wow. An 11 in the whole series, tied for the series lead with, well, you know who. And more importantly, a Stanley Cup. So the playoffs read like this. 12 goals, 25 assists for 37 points. Second best in the playoffs, a record that still stands today for points by a defenseman in a playoff year. As a matter of fact, when Wayne Gretzky's 1990 autobiography, he said he felt Coffey deserved the Conn Smythe Trophy as playoff MVP more than him. Be that as it may, however, I doubt Paul's crying the blues over that. What a year! 37 goals, 84 assists for 121 points, leading all defensemen yet again for a fourth straight season. Fifth in the entire league, playing in his fourth consecutive All-Star game, and his first All-Star team selection, hallelujah, winning his first Norris Trophy, beginning the season with the Canada Cup and being named to the All-Star team. Truly brilliant in the playoffs, a record for points by a defenseman with 37 in his second Stanley Cup ring. Wow, can it get any better? Imagine being the Edmonton Oilers going into the 1985-86 season. You are two-time defending Stanley Cup champions. You had the best player in the game, plus not one, not two, but three star top-scoring forwards to go with him. And oh yes, that top-scoring defenseman that we've been talking about this whole video. You also had strong role players. The Oilers' depth does not get enough credit, but I assure you, names like Huddy, Greg, and Hunter are still well-known among fans in Edmonton. To his credit, Glenn Sather didn't stop building this team. The Oilers acquired one of the best two-way forwards in the game at the time in Craig McTavish. And they had young prospects in their system such as Essa the Pesta Tikkanen and Steve Smith. More on him later. Coffey is on a roll. He had his best year ever in 1984-85, and the Oilers were simply unstoppable. Their record? 56 wins. 119 points, and they were awarded the first ever President's Trophy as the league's top team. Surely that is a good thing, right? Right? Excuse me. Anyway, Paul Coffey had a record-setting year. Literally. And on yours truly's third birthday, Paul Coffey tied Tom Bladen's record of 8 points by a defenseman in a single game. 8 points. Most of Bobby Orr's records were deemed unbreakable as well, but Coffey has come close more than once now. And during this season, he and the Oilers were on a tear. Not even injuries to the likes of Marc Messier could slow them down. Both Bobby Orr's points record and goals record were now in striking distance of Paul Coffey before we knew it. The record for goals is 46, and Coffey did reach 40 once. Points, the record, is indeed 139. Coffey's highest season was 126, but there was no stopping him in the 85-86 season. Make no mistake about it. And it came down to this. 3 games left in the entire year. At this point, Paul Coffey had 45 goals and 88 assists for 133 points. Yes, there's only 3 games left, but their schedule was pretty easy for the most part. As in the first game, they were facing the lowly Vancouver Canucks. Coffey just needs 2 goals to break the goals mark. But either 6 points to tie, or 7 points to break the record set by Bobby Orr for points by a defenseman this season in 1970-71. but the way he's been playing three games is enough for him to do it. So here we are, April 2nd against the Canucks, and in a shocking turn, the Canucks went up 2-0 early on. The Oilers got one back, however, from Mike Krushelnicki. With 34 seconds left in the period, however, Coffey sets up Curry beautifully, and the game is tied, and Coffey has a point. Point number 134. And just 11 seconds later, Coffey scored a big goal as Northlands Coliseum erupted. The goal record is tied at 46. Yeah! And early in the second period, it truly happens. Coffey does it. He breaks the single-season goal record by defenseman as he scores his 47th goal of the season. Truly outstanding. He adds an assist later en route to an 8-4 win, so two goals and two assists for a 4-point night, meaning he has two games and 3 points remaining to break the record and quite possibly reach 50 goals. So the stage is set for a game in Calgary, now two games to go, and just one record left to break. It's not a very good outing for Coffey, however, as Edmonton played terribly. They lose 9-3 to their rivals, the Flames. The third goal of the game, however, being scored by Paul Coffey with 36 seconds to play. He's got 48, so he's a step closer. Even with one game left, he could very well tie the record, and could very well get two goals for 50. The possibilities are endless, and the final regular season game of the year is against the lowly Canucks again, this time in Vancouver, and Coffey is ready. He has opportunities. As a matter of fact, he has 4 shots on goal, but he comes up empty. Not a single point. He falls one short of tying Bobby Orr's single-season points record. But hey, no need to be sad. He had one of the single greatest seasons of any player has had, period. Not just defensemen. I will wholeheartedly say that. Well, obviously, for the 5th straight year, he finished first among defensemen in scoring. Duh. And third in the league with 138 points. Yes, because some giant kid from Montreal, Quebec, decided he was going to be the next big thing in hockey and finished second behind Gretzky. So selfish, I say. Also, Coffey's career year, all career highs across the board, was also matched with a career high of plus 61. Good enough for fourth in the league. And yes, I'll see you the surprise, he won the Norris Trophy, his second straight. And also he came in 4th place for Hart Trophy voting, barely missing out on being a finalist. And now we get the Gretzky numbers. Wayne had 52 goals, oh wait, 52? 52? By God, Wayne, that's the second lowest of your career. 52? That's what you usually have by the All-Star breaking. Oh yeah, I should also add he had 163 assists that year. Seriously, even if he had scored 0 goals, he'd have won the scoring title by 22 points. He smashed the single-season assist record of 135 that he had set the year prior and broke his own single-season scoring record of 212 with 215. So let's see how our pal Paul did working with Wayne on this unstoppable Oilers club. Now, I mentioned Wayne had 52 goals this season. Coffey assisted on 15 of them, 28.8%. And again, the second best again, well, you know who by now. Anyway, yes, he assisted on 19 of those. But anyway, now how many of those huge 48 goals that Coffey scored did Gretzky assist on? My guess would be, well, a lot. And indeed, it was 31! 64.6%! And now the assist collaborators, and whoa boy, a lot to go through. But again, it's Curry and Coffey neck and neck, back and forth, running away with it, with the former edging Coffey out with 34 to Coffey's 31. So now it's playoff time. No question in anyone's mind that the Oilers dynasty is going to dominate going the rest of the way. The opening round sees them face that very same lowly Canucks team. Yes, the playoffs were weird back then. They outscored Vancouver 17-5 in an easy 3-game sweep. Coffey is in fine form. 1 goal, 3 assists, 4 points, and plus 3 in 3 games. Next up was the third Battle of Alberta. The Oilers easily won the first one in 83 and were taken to a 7th game in 84. Here we go. Game 1 is absolutely brutal for the Oilers. A 4-1 win from the Flames. Coffey is minus 3 on the entire evening. But hey, these things happen in the playoffs, as I always say. And Game 2 actually goes to overtime. Clutch hero Glenn Anderson saves the day just a minute in. Coffey plays much better. The series shifts to Calgary, and thanks to their amazing defense, the Oilers have no answer in a 3-2 loss. Coffey is held off the score sheet and doesn't play very well. But Game 4, the Oilers return with an emphatic message. A 7-4 win thanks to a 5-point night from Gretzky. The series is tied heading back to Edmonton. But rookie goaltender Mike Vernon just can't be solved. After a 30-save performance, the Calgary scorers deliver in a shocking 4-1 win. Now the Oilers find themselves in a place they haven't been since the 83 finals, on the verge of elimination. The Oilers work cohesively, however, with a huge 5-2 win in Game 6, now forcing a 7th and deciding game. Oh, did you Calgary fans get your hopes up? Game 7? Going back to Edmonton, you say? The Flames are about to be dust with an extinguisher named... Wait, Hockenlube? Shorthanded? Okay, so the Flames got one, and hey, to their credit, they played great in this series. It's no surprise. But Poplinski? It's 2-0? Oh boy, no, this cannot be happening. Someone needs to step up for crying out loud. And what would you look at that? Like he often does in the clutch, Glenn Anderson finally gets the Oilers on board. Northland's Coliseum wakes up in the process from their nap. With less than a minute to play, however, in that period, here's Mark Messier, also known for scoring important playoff goals throughout his career, and this game is tied going into the third. Oh, Calgary, you have nothing left. And man, this third period is kind of slow. And oh, look, okay, C. Smith's going to try to clear this out. And he put it in his own net. God damn you, mother piece of shit bastard. What the hell? Okay. Calm down, Bill. There's still over 14 minutes to play. And okay, well, 10 minutes now. And there's still lots of... 5 minutes, okay. I'm getting a little concerned. 1 minute. Come on, Glenn. Gretz, Coffey, where are ya? No. 3, 2, 1. Calgary. Calgary wins? Steve Smith, you no good mother. Please. God damn venom. Okay. I'm good. Okay, now that my anger has subsided, I can finally focus on the many reasons why the Oilers lost the series. Once again, they reverted back to their relaxed ways. They're not nearly as disciplined as they were the previous two seasons. Mark Messier played terribly most of the series. Even Curry wasn't bringing much of anything and held a one goal. He was minus 3. As for our hero, he was held goalless. But he did have 6 assists, but was also minus 3. Not a great way to end such a spectacular season. Again, I say, f*** you, Steve Smith, and f*** you and President's Trophy, and... Oh, but thank you, Patrick Waugh, for beginning your path to being the best ever and my all-time favorite player, so I'm not really that mad. Despite the dynasty's derailment and heartbreaking end, Coffey still had an epic season. A new record 48 goals, 90 assists, for 138 points, all career highs, just 1 point shy of Bobby Orr's record of 139 in the season. Another All-Star Game appearance, a first-team All-Star selection for the second straight year. This year was not a complete loss at all. Now, going into the 1986-87 season, the Oilers were determined to get back on track and regain the Stanley Cup again. The Oilers were off to a pretty good start, but not a great one. They weren't the dominant force they'd been in the past, at least not at first. Many players, some fair and none, some unfair, had come under some scrutiny. Paul Coffey was among one of them. Going into the 25th game of the season, they were 14-9-1, the Oilers were. While not exactly a sign of a team on the decline, it was certainly triggering a lot of skeptics. Coffey, however, had 33 points in 24 games, 7 goals, and 26 assists to be exact, and was plus 7 on the year so far. Indeed, while some argued against him, many were still for him, saying that he along with Gretzky were the only two star players playing very consistently at this point. Some would even argue he was on his way to a Norris Trophy win again, as he was leading all defensemen in scoring by a very good margin, even early in the season. Yes, indeed, it was all looking good and oh, wait, that's my 80s fax machine. Well, in his seventh season, Paul Coffey had to deal with something he'd never really dealt with in his career. Injuries. As a matter of fact, at this point, prior to this season, he'd only missed 7 games in his entire career in his first 6 seasons, and most of those were actually in his rookie season. He missed a total of 10 games from late November to late December, and another 10 from January to February. He'd miss one more for the rest of the year, missing a total of 21 games, also causing him to miss the All-Star Showdown with the Soviet Union called Rendezvous 87, which he was indeed selected to play. It was a tough year for Coffey, but not a bad one, and he persevered. The Oilers finished with 106 points, first overall again in the league, meaning they won that damn President's Trophy again. Hot dog. Coffey, to his credit, however, finished with 17 goals and 50 assists for 67 points in 59 games. Very admirable, as he managed to still finish tied for 5th among defensemen in scoring with those 67 points, and again, also very admirable, and he was tied with Phil Housley of Buffalo and was a plus 12. Safe to say he wasn't taking home the Norris Trophy this year, and wouldn't even be a finalist, but he was still 5th in votes. But there's still some numbers to look into, and oh, what, did you think I was gonna stop? Come on. Okay, so Wayne Gretzky had 62 goals and 121 assists for 183 points in the 86-87 regular season. It always kills me when he's in a slump. Anyway, out of those 62 goals, let's see how much Coffey assisted on. He did indeed assist 9 of 62 of Gretzky's goals, 14.5%, the lowest since his rookie year, but that's to be expected. Still tied for 4th best, however, with Glenn Anderson. And it wasn't even Curry who had the most this year. It was another Finnish born forward, and Esa Tiikanen was 17. Speaking of 17, that's how many goals Coffey had, and Gretzky assisted on 9 of them, above half, around 53%. No shocker there, of course. And now to the assist collaborations. Coffey was somehow still 3rd best, just ahead of Marc Messier with 13. So now here's a new stat we're going to go over for this video. It's how did Gretzky do without Coffey in the games that he missed? Let's find out. So Coffey missed 21 games overall in the regular season, however, Gretzky only missed 1. The final game of the season, both Gretzky and Coffey were healthy scratches to rest up for the playoffs. So let's go over the 20 games that Gretzky played without him. So Coffey missed 10 games between November 28th and December 23rd. Before that, they had played 25 games together. In those first 25 games, Gretzky had 58 points, averaging 2.3 points a game. In the 10 games that Coffey misses, however, the first 10, Gretzky actually averages nearly 3 points a game at 2.9, to be exact. Well, what does this show? It shows that Gretzky merely had to step it up in Coffey's absence, which Gretzky was always good at doing in the absence of star players. Coffey returns on December 23rd, and he plays the next 12 games, until going out of action again on January 21st. The span of games, Gretzky averaged 2.25 points a game. As Coffey goes down again. In that time span, Gretzky is averaging slightly less than before, but still a huge 2.8 points a game in this absence of Coffey. But Bill, you have pretty much proven that the Oilers don't need Coffey to win. Remember, this is a video about how Coffey clicks with the star forwards Gretzky, and it also shows the maturity of the star forwards. Had this happened 2 years ago, Gretzky may not have fared very well, but it's mere speculation and we'll never truly know. But be that as it may, they play the next 22 games together without it saying, oh yes, Gretzky averages 1.86 points a game. So what does this prove? Gee, Bill, it still proves to me Gretzky don't need Coffey. It just proves how good the Oilers really are in this sense. In Coffey's absence, Gretzky and the others carried a heavier load, and they did that, and the numbers don't lie. But when Coffey came back, obviously he was contributing offensively, averaging over a point a game still. Coffey was, of course, down from 1.7 points a game last year to 1.13. Still nothing to sneeze at. Gretzky the year prior, however, was also down. He was 2.7, down to a 2.3. Yari Curry had just over 1.7 points in a game in his own right, and then also saw a decrease of Glenn Anderson taking a dip from 1.4 to 0.9 a game. Messier, however, went up from 1.3 to 1.5 this year. Also, Esa Tiikanen had a breakout year, getting more ice time, being put together more often with Gretzky averaging over a point a game. And again, you ask, what's the damn point? It shows the Oilers had more players contributing than ever. It's about being more cohesive as a unit as a whole. I'm not saying the Oilers players worried about stats above winning the year prior, but it seemed in this campaign they were worried even less about producing statistically individually and more about producing as a cohesive team and having a good season and bringing out the best possible to go all the way and not have a repeat performance of the last season. It showed a player could step up in times of need. It shows that young stars, such as Esa Tikkanen, were emerging. This may very well be the most complete Oilers team in this era in terms of star power, depth, attitude, and determination, even if they weren't the most dominant like in 84. And now it's playoff time. The opening round saw the Oilers taking on the Los Angeles Kings, who, despite having a losing record, bolstered some amazing young rookie talents such as Steve Dasheen, Jimmy Carson, and Rookie of the Year, Luc Robitaille, along with Bernie Nichols having taken over Marcel Dion's role as the top center on the club. The Kings shocked the Oilers in Game 1, and Paul Coffey's injury issues came up once again, and he'd miss the rest of the series. Be that as it may, the Oilers crushed the Kings 13-3 in Game 2. And while the Kings were competitive after that, they still lost the next three games, as the Oilers won the series in 5 games, as the first round was now a best-of-7 series. Paul Coffey, of course, couldn't contribute all that much, only just playing the one game. Coffey is back, however, in time for Game 1 of the Smythe Division Final against the Winnipeg Jets, and this time, the Jets have Dale Hawerchuk, but it didn't make a lick of difference. The Oilers again sweep them in 4 straight. Coffey's ice time was limited in the first couple of games due to his injuries, and actually played a pretty good defensive role when he was on ice. Are you happy now, people? And he did go pointless, however, but still had a +2 rating. And in the conference finals now, a new foe awaited them. The Detroit Red Wings, who just a few years prior were known as the Detroit Dead Things, but with new head coach Jacques Demers, and their star young captain and top scorer, Steve Yzerman. Haha, funny name, right? The Red Wings, however, were going into this series fearless and took Game 1 in convincing fashion. And to the Red Wings' credit, they did everything right through the series. Yzerman also played a smart defensive game and held Gretzky just 2 assists in the whole 5 games, and no goals! Curry himself only had 1 goal, but remember what I said about the Oilers? Now having a team so good, others can step up. Well, the likes of Mark Messier, Kent Nielsen, Glenn Anderson, Craig McTavish, and yes, Paul Coffey were all tremendous, as the Red Wings lost the series in 5 games. Coffey had a goal and 4 assists for 5 points and was a +2, and back to form. And now the Oilers are going back to the Stanley Cup Finals, and in their way, the Philadelphia Flyers once again, the same team they vanquished 2 years ago. But this team is now a little wiser, a little more determined, and oh yes, Ron Hextall, and that kind of helps too. Well, Game 1 in Edmonton, Gretzky and Coffey, as well as a 29-save performance from Grant Fuhr, give them a 4-2 win. Game 2, the Flyers are a little more aggressive, but this time it takes overtime. And Coffey caps off another big game by setting up Jari Kurri's overtime winner. The Oilers take the first 2 games at home, heading back to Philly for the next 2. I think most people knew this wasn't going to be a sweep, however. The Flyers come back in Game 3, as the Oilers blow a 3-0 lead and lose 5-3. But the Oilers roar back in Game 4 with a big 4-1 win, and are just 1 game away from getting back to the top of the mountain as they head home. In Game 5, it's looking good. They have a 3-1 lead early in the second period, but the Flyers fought back to tie it. And in the third period, Rick Tocchet scored an early goal, and Ron Hextall made 31 saves in the game and was brilliant. We're going back to Philly for Game 6. And the Oilers have a 2-1 lead in Game 6 with just 10 minutes to go. All they need to do is hold on for half a period to win it all, and actually win their first Stanley Cup on the road. But with just under 7 minutes to play, Brian Propp ties it. And nearly a minute and a half later, J.J. Danio scores a huge goal. Hey, wait a minute, J.J. Danio? J.J. Danio? J.J. f***ing Danio? Okay, don't get me wrong, I'll always have love for J.J. because of his time with the 93 Habs and how good he was then. But really? J.J. Danio? Ugh. Hextall holds them in, and we're off to Game 7. Oh boy, it's a tense atmosphere. Winner takes all at the Northlands Coliseum. And Coffey, who has been held pointless in the last 2 games, finds himself in the penalty box, along with Mark Messier, just barely over a minute in. And the Flyers have a 2-minute advantage and score. However, Mark Messier makes up for his bad behavior and scores a tie-in later in the period. Yari Curry then scores a beauty in the second period, and the Oilers take the lead. It's tight. It's exciting. A thrilling game with close calls, big saves, great defense, and everyone is on the edge of their seat. And with under 3 minutes to play, however, Glenn Anderson launches that now infamous shot from about 30 feet out, 5-hole on Hextall. 3-1 Oilers. And not long after, 1987 Stanley Cup champions. Coffey played very well in his first three games, and didn't necessarily play bad the rest of the way, but it wasn't a factor on the score sheet. But either way, what a great way to end what must have been a very long season. Coffey had 67 points in 59 games in a season marred with injuries. He still came in fifth for Norris Trophy voting and got his name on the Stanley Cup for a third time, playing pretty well, especially in the conference final in the first few games of the Cup. Little did anyone know at the time, but as the Oilers skated around with the Stanley Cup, including Paul Coffey, he was playing his last game as an Edmonton Oiler. Well, of course, we'll cover that on our next video. In his time with Edmonton, however, he spent 7 whole seasons there. His collaboration with Gretzky was truly something to behold. 669 points he had in his time there. He left the Oilers as the 7th all-time leading scoring defenseman in NHL history at the age of just 26 years old. His work with Gretzky was truly something to behold. In terms of assisting on Gretzky's goals, only 2 out of 7 seasons with the Oilers, his first and his last, did he not finish at least second. He finished first once in the other 4 seasons, with second to Yari Curry. No big surprise there. Now, Curry was always great and was likely the better partner for Gretzky, but think of this. Coffey had more assists than Curry every year they played together, meaning that Paul could spread the wealth a bit to a lot more other players too. I truly believe that Coffey was the more complete player out of the 2 in the Oilers dynasty. As for collaborating assists with Gretzky, both men were pretty much dead even every year, being the 2 most notorious Gretzky collaborators even with setting up goals. But again, Coffey was able to spread it around a bit more. As for what he accomplished, well, this picture says it all, does it not? 3 Stanley Cups, Canada Cup, as well as a tournament All-Star, 2 Norris Trophies as a league's top defenseman, 5 NHL All-Star Game appearances, 2 first All-Star team selections, 3 second All-Star team selections. Is it the single season goal mark for a defenseman with 48? And oh yeah, there's other 2 things in the pictures of President's Trophies. I needed to fill space. And that is it for Paul Coffey in Edmonton. Tune in for part 2 next week as we talk about the Pittsburgh Penguins era. After he has played 7 seasons with the great one, he now gets to play alongside with the magnificent one. Please like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video and leave a comment below on things you would like to see from this channel. Until next time, so long.